5:01 PM on March 29, 2020. I stood face to face with the devil. There was something so violent about it, and my blood ran cold. My instinct had told me to turn away, and I'd done it so many times before, but in my moment, I needed to sit. And I found Jason. Little did I know back then, that would also become my redemption. You see, the road to that moment started 2 months earlier. One morning, I went to every year to go out of bed, back to bed, and left. I was devastated. But instead of letting myself feel what happened, as well most can do, I buried my emotions and walked away my thoughts. Instead of distracting myself with long hours at work and filling my nights with partying and drinking, I could stand the idea of being alone with my mind and my thoughts. I managed to keep myself from breaking apart, even though it was the worst thing I'd seen, and believe it or not, I was actually quite successful with the Band-Aid solution. We called it years of practice. But almost as it wanted to, the world fell into its own state of chaos. The pandemic had forced involuntary isolation, and just as I thought it was finally getting to work on my new reality, I found myself sitting inside a tiny condo trying to reconcile all of the gallery. At this time, without the distractions, the little bars, the clubs, the sports on TV, the long hours at work. On one extra long journey, it all came crashing down on me. I'm sitting on the floor of that condo thinking, "This isn't felt so big." In that moment, I never felt more alone, more afraid, so vulnerable. See, something had triggered in me that hadn't happened in many, many, many years. It broke down. It shook me to my core, and suddenly everything around me just went black. What I know now, but I didn't realize at the time, is that the reason I broke down as far as I did wasn't just because of the loss of the relationship. It wasn't just because of the chaos and uncertainty of the world around me. I was crying all the tears of a little boy inside that held back for over 30 years. The tears on the bed of a young boy who never gave himself a chance to grieve the sudden death of his great uncle. Or the tears on the bed of a young man who never gave himself a chance to grieve his first heartbreak. Why? Because he'd always been told that men don't cry. Told that young girls would be a big, strong man, don't express emotions like sadness or vulnerability. And certainly don't cry. But that's in direct opposition to our masculinity. Crying is not a masculine or feminist behavior. It's not tied to how strong or how weak we can be. Rather, it's the body's defense mechanism, a way of unleashing toxins and stress hormones from your system. Unlike the tears you get from cutting an onion or shoving your toe, emotional tears are different. It's a natural breakdown. After the death of a loved one. Or in high-stress situations filled with fear and anxiety. To think of the time you were holding it all in, how good it felt to let it all out. And now imagine you were holding it in for 30 years to do to a man. But men don't cry, right? Now, when someone close to that side, you know, men, we hold back. Now, other men, Hollywood society, bury those emotions, move forward, man up. Controlling and burying those emotions, remaining strong and steady, is the true test of our masculinity. But at what cost? Growing up, I idolized men like Hulk Hogan, who taught me to engage with other men with strength, intimidation, and machismo. The women who accompanied the alpha male to the breast were seen as weak and less attractive. It was of the utmost importance that I lived by this unwritten code of ethics. But then, at what cost? So when I was in the lowest moment, sitting on that condo floor, I finally picked myself back up. and I go to watch his face. I'm going to tell the difference between what was water versus what was tears. And when I looked up, I first saw him. The only person was even staring right back at me. Not a lot of people would think to capture the world's moment in life. It's not something that typically occurs to you, but I did. And this was a face looking back at me. I hope I've never shown anyone from this moment here today, or even my partner here in the audience. This is my personal reminder of never again. So there I was, ill-equipped and full of raw emotions, ready to do a whole self-improvement thing. That's how I know it was ever. I'm ready to have news of speaking to a therapist because only meet people speak to therapists, right? So instead, I went to my phone book looking for someone to speak to, settled on the name of a man I felt I hardly knew, but there was something comforting about having a conversation with someone who felt a little more like a stranger than like a friend. So I picked up the phone and called. I was ready to talk about anything, sports, life, the pandemic, before jumping into the real reason I called. But to my surprise, he started the conversation by expressing his insecurities and his vulnerabilities. Suddenly, my shoulders dropped. My fear of judgment vanished. I was present. That one conversation made me attempt to have a meaningful connection with another human being and taught me that there's strength in vulnerability, not weakness. And I thought this was important because when I was finally ready to enter into another romantic relationship, I thought I'll speak my truth because the alternative was that dark hole I never wanted to be in again. And unfortunate, because she showed me and continues to show me that when necessary, I can express those vulnerabilities without fear of being judged, being unmanly, or unsexy. And that part's important because the social media narratives have convinced me that we can't have these conversations out in the open. So as I continue on this journey of self-discovery, armed with my curiosity to become a better man, a better person, I had an opportunity to start a podcast. We called it Dance Talk. The idea was simple. Pull the curtain back on conversations related to mental health, life, wellness. My very first guest was a legendary comedian, Russell Peters. And in that conversation, I asked Russell how the pandemic had treated him, to which he replied, "It was the darkest days of his life." See, Russell had lost the ability to see the sun in that moment that his fame or his fortune mattered anymore. Shocked. How could a generational, influential man like that confide something so dark and so deep in someone like me, another man for that matter? In that moment, it was lightning in a bottle. How had become a journey of discovery to conversation with some of the world's most incredible people. So what did I learn? A world-class soccer player, the only thing that I can talk about how, no matter how well he played, he could get everyone to love him. A world-renowned CEO talked about how growing up in extreme poverty impacts him to this day, despite having enough fortune to retire future grandchildren if he wanted to. A rap artist who belongs to one of the world's greatest record labels talked about how hard it is to be a good man and a good father, while making an income in an industry that promotes violence, machismo, and substances. One by one by one, these gentlemen would share their deepest, darkest moments with me. And after an hour of intimate conversation, we remarked how therapeutic it was to finally talk. This conversation showed me that neither fame nor fortune can mask away what generations of men have been struggling with. That there's a universal need amongst us to have a safe environment where we feel comfortable speaking. And this is important because the alternative is a battle between life and death. The Mental Health Commission came out with a report saying suicide is the second leading cause of death amongst men aged 15 to 39. Do you know what the leading cause is? Now, this all sounds overwhelming. Probably you're wondering, what can I do about it? Very simple. You go to someone that's going through something. Reach out. Send them a text. Create an environment where they feel comfortable speaking. And how to the gentleman in your audience here. I want to have conversations with you directly with a woman. I know what it's like to feel alone, judged, ridiculed. I'm here to tell you that if you let yourself sit in those negative emotions, you will find yourself hurting for a very, very long time. Instead, I ask you to work through it. Seek out therapy. Talk to a friend. I promise you will find the peace you're looking for. To not do so, will leave you on a path of darkness and emptiness. Your relationships will follow your right path to life. Always and holding on so tightly. That fear of judgment from the people in your life shouldn't be there because those people shouldn't be in your life. If there's anything you take away from this talk, that you have, you're worth it. The world, it's not a better place without you.